Welcome to lesson two of the SunShot Solar Outreach Partnership Solar Powering Your Community presentation series. My name is Chad Laurent from Meister Consultants Group. And in this lesson, we're going to be talking about local solar ordinances. As far as the lesson plan, we're going to talk about solar ordinances, what they are and why they're useful, solar permitting, and solar zoning. So just as a refresher, there are significant costs of solar power associated with soft costs. These soft costs include paperwork, permitting, installation labor, and customer acquisition costs. And there's a real opportunity for local governments to tackle the permitting aspect of soft costs through things like solar ordinances and solar zoning practices. So what is a solar ordinance? A solar ordinance is a regulatory framework that encourages responsible solar development while preserving the public health, safety, welfare, and the general character of the community. So how do you go about encouraging solar development while still protecting public health, safety, welfare, and other aesthetic aspects of the community? These two goals do not have to be mutually exclusive. So one of the issues is inconsistency in the permitting process. There are over 18,000 jurisdictions in the United States that have a unique zoning and permitting requirements, thus making it complicated both for homeowners as well as solar developers. And again, this adds the time that it takes to install a solar system. It requires over 7 times the number of man hours to permit a system in the United States as compared to Germany, which drives the cost of permitting up by over 21 times that as compared to Germany. This creates an enormous amount of paperwork. This is the example of the paperwork associated with a PV system that was installed in California. As you can see, it's numerous forms. A mistake can be made on any one of those forms. This isn't just the local permitting, this is also some of the federal forms and federal tax credit forms, but needless to say, it's a complicated process. When you compare this to Germany's unified process, there's 1 2-page form that receives all necessary permits. So it's simplified, standardized, and streamlined the permitting process, which saves time and money. So a solar ordinance provides and helps to ensure that responsible solar development occurs through a consistent and transparent process. And this is a benefit not only to homeowners and developers, but also to municipal staff who have to deal with processing, approving, and looking at all the various permits associated with getting a PV system installed within your community. So again, we want to focus on how you balance growth with regulation. So how does a local government define what types of solar installations are right for their community? So there's basically a 3-step process. First, determine what the community's goals are. How much solar do we want installed? What types of solar installations do we want installed? Do we want them to be rooftop systems or ground-mounted systems? And then how do those goals integrate into the planning process? So most communities go through some form of master planning process. How can solar be incorporated into that process? In addition, then you want to develop the ordinance that is informed by plans. So which areas are suitable for solar, which areas do you want to see solar development, and how does that relate back to the planning process and the ultimate plan that is in the community? So there are 3 different components to a solar ordinance. First, there are zoning standards. Second, solar access and solar rights provisions. And finally, the permit application process. So first we're going to talk about solar zoning standards. So there's a particular framework that may be useful when looking at what type of zoning standards to apply. First is the definition. So what type of technology are you focusing on? Here we're mostly talking about solar photovoltaics, which are rooftop or ground-mounted systems. The applicability of those systems. So are they a primary use of the property or an accessory use to the property? What sort of dimensional standard should be put forth in the zoning standard? So height restrictions, size restrictions in terms of the area that the panels take up on the land, any setbacks both from the roof line as well as the property boundaries, and how much of a lot could be covered by solar. And finally, design standards. So is there signage that's required, disconnect switches for utility worker safety, screening or fencing to mitigate visual impacts. Those can all be written into a zoning standard for photovoltaics or solar. So the majority of systems that would be installed in a community are generally going to be small systems. So typically these systems are permitted as an accessory use to the property. So the property is primarily being used for energy generation, but it's merely a rooftop system that supplements the energy used by that home. In most cases, 85% of all rooftop systems are the same or similar in their design and function. And so this can definitely help streamline the process and sort of fast track the zoning standards applied to these types of systems. You may want to look at minimizing visual impacts if that's feasible, looking at where the system is located, whether it faces the street, but again, making sure that the system is appropriately designed and the homeowner is able to take advantage of south-facing roof space. Next, there may be different dimensional requirements, district heights, lot coverage, or setbacks within particular historic districts or parts of the community that may be affected if there were a large number of rooftop systems installed. As far as large solar is concerned, here large systems would generally be allowed for primary use in limited locations. So there may be capped landfills or brownfield sites that may be particularly advantageous to put in a large ground-mounted system because these lots are not being used for other purposes. Again, the types of requirements that may be in the zoning standard, height limitations, lot coverage, setbacks or safety, and then also, in this case, there may be fencing or different enclosures to keep animals or other people from wandering onto the property that has the PV system. So there are a number of excellent resources available to local governments on model ordinances and model codes in terms of zoning and planning for solar. One in particular is the Essential Info Packet from the American Planning Association. So we highly recommend that you take a look at this resource at planning.org. Next up, we're going to talk a little bit about solar access and solar access laws. So solar access laws increase the likelihood that properties will receive sunlight. So the panels need to be unshaded and unobstructed in order for the homeowner or the business to be able to take advantage of the solar resource. And so they need to have a law in place that grants them access to that sunlight. It protects the rights of property owners to install solar. So this is where a solar rights or solar access provision can sort of go ahead of homeowner association requirements or other potential restrictions that might limit the ability of a homeowner to actually install the system on their home. And finally, solar access provisions can reduce the risk that systems will be shaded after the installation. So ordinances that deal with solar access can require vegetation to be cut if it were to grow up and begin shading a system. So a number of states have passed some form of solar access, solar rights, or solar easement provisions. Solar rights laws at the state level would apply uniformly to all municipalities within the state. Solar easement provisions allow for homeowners to negotiate agreements between their neighbors as to allowing access to the sunlight or keeping vegetation trimmed. And then some states, and one of the key takeaways from this slide, is that some states have solar access provisions that allow municipalities to adopt the state standard. And so a municipality may or may not have chosen to actually go through that process. So it's important when you're looking at these provisions to see where you stand, whether your state has a solar access provision in place, or whether you need to go to a process to adopt that standard. This map is from the Database for State Incentives for Renewable Energy, DESIRE for short. So you should definitely refer back to that website in order to get the latest updates on where these provisions stand and latest maps. So an excellent resource for solar access laws is a model guide and comprehensive review of solar access laws in the United States provided by the Solar American Board of Codes and Standards. So we definitely suggest that you check out this resource for model language that you can adopt in your municipality. So next we're going to talk about permit administration. Expedited permitting can provide a tremendous opportunity to streamline the process and make it simple and less costly both for homeowners and businesses as well as municipal staff. So as an example, communities in California with favorable permitting practices saw between 4 and 12% lower costs for solar and a 25% shorter development time as compared with communities that were using the standardized permitting process, which is a tremendous cost and time savings, again, not only for homeowners, but also for municipal staff. So what are some solar permitting best practices? The first is a fair and flat fee process. So fees generally based on the cost that is incurred by the municipality to process that permitting fee. Second, electronic or over-the-counter issuance of permits. So as municipalities look to update their permitting processes to get them online or to have a fast track over-the-counter system, solar should definitely be considered in that process. It saves time for everyone involved. Standardized permit requirements. As I mentioned, roughly 80 to 85% of all small rooftop homeowner PV systems are generally the same. So there's real opportunities to standardize permit requirements and standardize the types of forms, create a checklist to simplify and streamline that process. Finally, making all of these electronic materials available online and having checklists available is another way to expedite that process. Next, it is key that you provide training for permitting staff in solar. Many municipal permitting staff may be unfamiliar. They have not permitted a lot of solar installations within their jurisdiction. They may not be familiar with the technology. And so it's key for the municipality to go through a training process to make sure that everyone is up to speed on what the requirements are and how the process will work. Removing excess reviews is critical. So the need for extraneous or independent engineering review is often not needed, especially for small rooftop systems. So there's real opportunities there to save time in the process. Again, reduction of inspection appointment windows is also a key way to cut costs. Now everyone complains about having to be around between 12 and 4 for the cable guy to come up and install things. And this wouldn't be unique just to solar systems. If you're getting a new furnace installed or something like that, you may have to wait for the electrical inspection. But to the extent possible, there's an opportunity to reduce time and cost by reducing those appointment windows. And then finally, the utilization of standards and certification. So again, there's ways to look to see whether installers have national certifications in place, and there may be a fast track or more streamlined process available for installers who meet those national certifications. And it's also important to note that most panels and equipment, inverters in the panels, are tested by national and international testing and rating and certification agencies. So as long as panels and equipment that meet those standards are being used, that may help eliminate the need for excessive reviews while still maintaining public health and safety requirements. A great resource for expedited permitting is again from the American Board of Codes and Standards. They have an expedited permitting guide that can walk you through the process of setting up and provide language for simplified requirements for PV applications, facilitating the efficient review of the content of those applications, as well as minimizing the need for those detailed studies and unnecessary delays. Another resource worth looking at for expedited permitting is the Interstate Renewable Energy Council's Emerging Approaches for Efficient Rooftop Solar Permitting. They have a best practice paper that gives a number of examples of communities that have implemented expedited permitting, and IREC in general provides a number of great resources. So that concludes lesson 2 on solar ordinances. Next up will be understanding the solar regulatory landscape.